Tamter Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Primer of Life Histories, Ecology, Evolution, and Application by Jeffrey A. Hutchings. Narrated by Mike Cooper. Publisher's note. The print and ebook versions of this book include visual elements. You'll hear the visuals discussed and referenced in this audiobook. Preface. Science is a way of seeing the world through description, analysis, and interpretation of empirical patterns and processes. Many of the mechanics of science are technical in nature. One may need to know how to run a model simulation, isolate DNA, set a trap, raise seedlings, use a centrifuge, operate a boat engine. The technical demands of research are often obvious. Less obvious is the need to identify a contextual, interpretive, and analytical framework that allows you to make sense of research findings and to draw conclusions about their potential utility or significance. Are there overarching principles, theories, or other generalities that would aid you in interpreting your research, communicating it to others, and increasing the probability that your work will, in some small or large way, advance knowledge and understanding? As a naive master's student in the early 1980s, I struggled to identify such a framework. I had little confidence in my ability to distinguish fundamentally important from fundamentally mundane questions. My confidence received an unexpected boost by Stephen Stern's 1976 review on life history evolution, written when he was a graduate student at University of British Columbia. It offered a fresh, taxonomically broad way of thinking about adaptation and natural selection. Why, indeed, should an organism reproduce once in its life and die immediately thereafter? By 1992, sufficient life history data were available that allowed for the testing of ideas, the poking of model assumptions, and the prodding of hypotheses. The stage was thus set for the first two general books on life history evolution. Stearns wrote one, Derek Roth of McGill University wrote the other. Although bearing the same title, Evolution of Life Histories, there were differences in how topics were approached. Reaction norms figured prominently in Stern's contribution. Quantitative genetics was emphasized by Roth. Joined by Roth's Life History Evolution, these works contributed immeasurably to the torrid pace of life history research that continues unabated. Figure 1. Given this apparent enthusiasm, it seemed an opportune time to engage and hopefully enthuse new generations of students and researchers on the grandeur of life history evolution, its theoretical underpinnings, and some practical applications. Comprising 10 chapters, this primer is intended to be accessible to readers from a broad range of academic backgrounds and experience who have interests in ecology, evolution, conservation, or resource management. Chapters 1 to 4 focus on core elements of life history theory, population growth, trait variability, trade-offs, genetic architecture, reaction norms, reproductive effort, and reproductive costs. Chapter 5 offers tractable means of estimating fitness and predicting optimal changes in life history using life tables. The next three chapters examine life history evolution in variable environments, including bet hedging, Chapter 6, theories for the evolution of offspring number and size, Chapter 7, and alternative reproductive tactics and strategies, Chapter 8. Chapters 9 and 10 bridge the fundamentals of life history theory to matters of applied interest from conservation and resource management perspectives. Scaling up from individuals to species, Chapter 9 illustrates how life histories are inextricably linked to the vulnerability of species to extinction, exploitation, and climate change. Chapter 10 completes the primer with a look at how life histories affect sustainable rates of exploitation and how exploitation can, in turn, affect life histories. The inspiration of this book is large enough. If it fails in its portrayal, the fault lies with an art that is deficient rather than an enthusiasm that is wanting. Jeffrey A. Hutchings, Halifax, Nova Scotia, Canada, 8th of January, 2021. 1. Fundamentals. 1.1. A Brief History of Life Histories. 1.1.1. Breadth. Two words are at the core of this book. Life and history. Considered singly, writing a primer on either would be presumptuous. But when combined, they offer the foundation of intellectually rewarding, scientifically tractable avenues of inquiry that are not specific to a particular taxon, plant or animal, biological scale, gene, genome, individual, population, species, or mechanism of change, physiology, development, plasticity, evolution. To be intellectually engaged in the study of life histories from an ecological and evolutionary perspective is to be intellectually engaged in breadth. Not all scientists are comfortable with breadth. Some consider it unwise or unhelpful to stray from the comforts of a constrained set of theoretical and empirical constructs that anchor many research programs. Others find breadth liberating, if not vital, to maintaining their intellectual engagement in science over a 30 or 40-year career. If you're used to thinking broadly, tackling a narrow research question can be approached with confidence. If you're used to thinking narrowly, tackling a research question of breadth can be daunting. To get a feel of the inherent breadth of life history research, consider a simple figure that illustrates how various factors influence individual life histories, along with some of the consequences these can have at the population level, figure 1.1. Rather than a mechanistically or formatively accurate flow diagram, think of this figure as a roughly organized corkboard into which various constituent elements of life histories have been pinned. Note that none of the elements is specific to a particular taxonomic group. This permits breadth of interest and breadth of inquiry. The box on the left subsamples a range of traits and processes that comprise an individual's phenotype, that is, its observable form. Following the curved arrow, we are reminded that these traits and processes are influenced through selection, by an individual's genes, the environment it experiences, and interactions between genotypes and their environment. The end result is a combination of life history traits that determines an individual's probability of surviving to and reproducing at various ages or stages, its life history. As we shall see in this chapter, an individual's life history determines individual fitness, the rate of increase in that individual's genes through time. From an applied and conservation perspective, the average fitness of individuals in a population can affect things such as sustainable rates of exploitation, fishing, forestry, hunting, speed and uncertainty of species or population recovery following depletion, and the ability of a population to persist following natural or human-induced disturbance. 1.1.2 Life History in the 19th Century. The concept of a life history today differs from that of the 1800s, when a life history was equivalent to a life cycle. Embryo to egg to larva to adult, seed to seedling to later vegetative, flowering and pollination stages. A life history was a description of the development of the presumed generic type of a particular species. That said, scientific thinking of life histories in the 19th century was not entirely devoted to descriptive summaries alone. Charles Darwin and Ernst Haeckel were among those who thought evolution to be involved insofar as it could affect things such as the length and number of life stages and their associated morphological and development features. After recognition of Georg Mendel's work on plant hybridization at the turn of the 20th century, scientists began to explicitly link life histories to genetics. As one example, in 1909, Adam Sedgwick, whose great-uncle of the same name guided Darwin's early studies, asked, "What is the relation of these developmental variations in structure, which successfully appear in an organism and constitute its life history, to the mutational variations which appear in different organisms of the same brood or species?" As the 1800s eased into the 1900s, life history studies were very much focused on individual species. There was a paucity of ecology, evolution, and genetics. There was a paucity of breadth. Things were about to change. 1.1.3 The Turning Point, 1930. Ronald Fisher was pivotal in the development of modern statistical science and mathematical population genetics. Less well appreciated are his foundational contributions to research on life history evolution. In the opening chapter of The Genetical Theory of Natural Selection, he argued that researchers who have accepted the concept of natural selection will direct their inquiries confidently towards a study of the selective agencies at work throughout the life history of organisms. It marked a pivotal turning point in the development and application of life history theory. Fisher bridged the gap between the 19th century concept of a life history and the early 20th century concept of natural selection. To do so, he seized a tool long used in studies of human population growth. To obtain a distinct idea of the application of natural selection to all stages in the life history of an organism, use may be made of the ideas developed in the actuarial study of human mortality. The ideas Fisher was referring to were human actuarial tables. Originally developed in the early 1800s for life insurance purposes, these tables summarized the probabilities that humans survive from one age to subsequent ages. Fisher went further, arguing that a life table of survival was, in itself, inadequate to express fully the relation between an organism and its environment. It concerns itself only with the chances of frequency of death and not at all with reproduction. By combining probabilities of age-specific survival with age-specific reproduction, he produced what ecologists and population biologists today would term a life table. Fisher showed how one could readily calculate the number of offspring that each newly born individual, or more precisely, genotype, would be expected to produce over that individual's lifetime. So, in addition to accounting for the probability of surviving from birth to subsequent ages, Fisher accounted for the rate of reproduction at each age. If each individual in the population produced, on average, sufficient numbers of offspring to exactly replace themselves, the population would remain stable. However, if the per individual or per capita production of offspring surviving to maturity was greater or less than one, that is, replacement, the population would increase or decline respectively. Fisher defined the per capita production of offspring as the Malthusian parameter of increase, named after Thomas Malthus, whose An Essay on the Principle of Population heavily influenced Darwin and Alfred Wallace. Fisher argued that the per capita rate of increase should be directly linked to the strength of natural selection. The greater the per capita production of offspring by individuals of a particular genotype, relative to the rate of other members in the same population, the greater the strength of selection. The necessity of accounting for reproduction when exploring how natural selection acts raised questions concerning the effort an individual should expend on reproduction. What are the consequences to future survival and reproduction associated with the present allocation of greater or lesser amounts of reproductive effort? An oft-quoted sentence from Fisher draws the reader's attention to these potential trade-offs. It would be instructive to know not only by what physiological mechanism a just apportionment is made between the nutriment devoted to the gonads and that devoted to the rest of the parental organism, but also what circumstances in the life history and environment would render profitable the diversion of a greater or lesser share of the available resources towards reproduction. Assuming that the resources available to an individual at any given age are fixed, their diversion to some facet of reproduction must come at the expense of not allocating those same resources to components of survival and future reproductive capacity, such as body maintenance, growth, metabolism, foraging, and vigilance. In other words, present reproductive effort likely comes at a future reproductive cost. Fisher speaks directly to his underlying postulate that the allocation of resources to reproduction, as opposed to other things, is related to circumstances in the life history and environment, that is, natural selection. By linking the 19th century evolutionary mute, stage-based concept of a life history to his 20th century ideas of how natural selection acts through genetic processes on age-based probabilities of survival, Fisher brought logical and mathematical clarity to how the strength of selection acting on genotypes varies with age and developmental stage. A new definition of what constitutes a life history emerged from his work, one that can be expressed in the following way. A life history describes how genotypes vary their age or stage-specific expenditure of reproductive effort in response to extrinsic and intrinsic factors that affect age-specific survival and fecundity. Or, more succinctly, life histories are the probabilities of survival and the rates of reproduction at each age in a lifespan. 1.1.4. 50 years on, 1930 to 1980. Fisher offered a turning point from 19th to 20th century thinking about life history variability and how natural selection acts on this variation. He laid the foundation for life history theory, but it was left to others to construct the explanatory and predictive frameworks for understanding why individuals differ so extraordinarily within and among species in the means by which they propagate genes to future generations. These efforts were stimulated by fundamental questions of life history evolution, examples of which are provided as points of departure for cameos that illustrate key developments in the 50 years that elapsed since the publication of Fisher's book. Question: why do some organisms breed multiple times, whereas others breed once and then die? Many organisms reproduce iteratively, or multiple times, throughout their lives. Others breed once and die shortly thereafter. Lamont Cole, who termed these life history patterns iteroparity and semelparity, respectively, was the first to explore their fitness consequences. Although Cole examined several facets of life histories, researchers have been somewhat obsessed with his paradox, subsection 6.2.1. Surprisingly, he concluded that a semelparous population that produced one offspring more than the mean fecundity, or number of offspring, b, of an iteroparous population would have the same rate of increase as the iteroparous population. Put another way, a semelparous population with mean fecundity of b plus 1 would have the same rate of increase as an iteroparous population with mean fecundity b. While adding a single offspring to a bird's clutch of 5 might sound plausible in rendering the fitness of semelparity equal to that of iteroparity, the same cannot be said for adding a single offspring to the million produced by a fish. The paradox is that if an extremely small increase in fecundity should favour semelparity over iteroparity, why is semelparity so uncommon? It turns out that Cole's model incorporated the assumption that iteroparous individuals experience no mortality, not even as very small eggs or seeds. Cole's paradox was solved when empirically realistic rates of juvenile mortality were incorporated and the costs of semelparity were rendered more intuitively reasonable. Lamentably, Cole's paradox has had a tendency to overshadow his other formative contributions to life history evolution. A mathematically skilled ecologist, he worked on reptiles, Cole was the first researcher to have overtly concurred with Fisher's perspective on the evolution of life histories, agreeing that any life history features affecting reproductive potential are subject to natural selection. His classic 1954 paper, The Population Consequences of Life History Phenomena, was the first since Fisher's book to include the words life history in the title, among the roughly 310 papers that cited Fisher between 1930 and 1955, Cole's is the only article to do so, according to Google Scholar. Question: why do some organisms start breeding early in life and others comparatively late in life? The key to answering this question is to understand how age at maturity affects fitness. Cole explored this issue in detail, demonstrating mathematically that fitness is highly sensitive to the age at which an organism first reproduces, especially at comparatively young ages. All else being equal, the younger you start reproducing, the higher your fitness. But because of life history trade-offs, such as the allocation of trade-off mentioned in subsection 1.1.3, also see chapter 4, all else is rarely equal when it comes to comparing the fitness associated with alternative ages at maturity. Despite the existence of trade-offs, age at maturity retains a dominant influence on fitness. Garth Murphy, who used models of Atlantic herring, Clypea haringus, to poke and prod Cole's paradox, concluded that age at maturity depends on the ratio and the stability of survival during the juvenile, pre-productive stage, relative to survival during the adult, reproductive stage, subsections 5.5.4 and 6.2.2. Murphy's work provided the basis for predicting how changes in survival and fecundity affect the evolution of age at maturity. Age at maturity is a life history trait. Cole may have been the first to explicitly articulate this connection, referring to it as a life history feature. He also identified fecundity and longevity as life history features or traits and predicted how they might affect rates of population change. At about the same time, some empirically minded ecologists were honing in on another life history trait, offspring size. Question: why do some organisms produce many small offspring and others few large offspring? For a fixed amount of effort, there is a clear trade-off between the number of offspring produced and the size of each of those offspring, be they seeds, eggs, or embryos. If you are interested in explaining the adaptive significance of variability in one of these two traits, offspring size and offspring number, you'll find yourself on intellectually thin ice if you do not account for variability in the other. More of that in Chapter 7. Early attempts to understand interspecific variability in offspring number within an evolutionary context can be traced to the ornithologist David Lack, whose work in the late 1940s centered on altricial birds, young fed by their parents at a nest. By assuming that the food that parents can feed their young is limited, Lack reasoned that the number of young produced cannot increase without a reduction in the amount of food provided to each of those young. In other words, the number of eggs laid reflects the optimal number of young that the parents can feed and/or provide parental care for. At the same time Lack was pondering the evolution of clutch size in birds, Gunnar Sverdsson, a Swedish fish biologist, was considering the evolutionary implications of how offspring size affects offspring number. Foreshadowing what was to come in the early 1970s, he suggested there must be an upper limit to offspring number that depended on how offspring size was related to offspring survival and parental reproductive success. 25 years later, Christopher Smith and Stephen Fretwell, using graphical models, provided an analytical solution for determining the optimal balance between offspring size and offspring number, subsection 7.4.3. Their simple model remains the starting point today for most explorations of the evolution of egg or seed size. Question: how costly is reproduction? The logical necessity of reproductive costs is based on the premise that organisms are energetically constrained systems. If energy required for growth, maintenance, and reproduction originates from the same fixed pool of resources, an allocation of energy to reproduction cannot be made without a reduced allocation to other body functions or activities. Chapter 4. The genetic basis for reproductive costs was initially explored by Peter Medawar and George Williams. In discussing the evolution of aging, or senescence, they argued that natural selection may favor a gene that has beneficial effects early in life, even if the same gene greatly reduces fitness later in life. Williams extended this theory to reproductive effort, reasoning that if energy allocation to present reproduction reduces future reproductive success, this cost of reproduction will result in the evolution of life histories that are characterized by intermediate levels of survival and reproduction. So, the greater the effort, the greater the subsequent cost. While such a causal link seemed self-evident, it was empirically unclear what this relationship might actually look like. The shape of the function relating reproductive effort to reproductive cost can strongly influence life history evolution. This is implicit in all theories that are based on the existence of reproductive costs. For example, different shapes of cost functions can lead to the evolution of either iteroparity or semilparity, or some combination of the two. Although cost functions are central to life history theory, few have been empirically described. Measuring the magnitude of reproductive costs remains a significant empirical challenge. 1.1.5 Life History Classics. The preceding subsections offered a brief history of the core elements of life history theory to 1980, by which time the foundations of modern approaches had essentially been set. Brevity inevitably involves exclusion, and some life history classics were not mentioned. The interested student and researcher might wish to delve deeper into these foundational papers and a small sample of other fundamentally instructive texts published after 1980, Table 1.1. Be it art, music, literature, or science, what constitutes a classic is in the eye of the beholder. 1.2. A primer of population growth. 1.2.1. Intrinsic rate of natural increase. Fisher placed mathematical population biology firmly at the forefront of scientific research on life history evolution. Yet, as vital as mathematics has been to the development of life history theory, the tendency for many biologists, young and old, to eschew quantitative analytics might well have served and continue to serve as a retarding force in life history research, particularly in the empirical testing of life history theory and its practical applications, of which there are multiple examples, chapters 9 and 10. As early as the mid-1950s, Cole was lamenting that studies of life histories have been neglected from the evolutionary point of view, apparently because the adaptive values of life history differences are almost entirely quantitative. Derek Roth concluded much the same thing almost 40 years later. An early antipathy to the use of mathematical analysis may account in part for the delay in the merging of the ecological and evolutionary perspectives in what is now commonly known as life history analysis. Fisher clearly did not share this antipathy, embracing Alfred Lotka's model for continuous population growth and applying it within a life history context. In a closed population, no immigration or emigration, growing at discrete time intervals, all births and deaths occurring at the same time every year, the number of individuals at time step t plus 1, n sub t plus 1, can be expressed as the number of individuals at time t, n sub t, plus the number of individuals born at time t, births sub t, minus the number of individuals that died at time t, deaths sub t. N sub t plus 1 equals n sub t plus births sub t minus deaths sub t. Equation 1.1. When modeling the change in population size from time step t to time step t plus 1, it is generally assumed that the likelihood of an individual giving birth or dying in that time interval will be fairly consistent. These are termed the per capita rates of birth, B, and death, D, such that births equals B multiplied by N. A rearrangement gives B equals births divided by N, and that deaths equals D multiplied by N, and D equals deaths divided by N. Substituting these per capita rates into a slightly rearranged equation, 1.1, yields the following expression. N sub t plus 1 equals n sub t plus b times n sub t minus d times n sub t. Equation 1.2, which can be rewritten as n sub t plus 1 equals open parentheses 1 plus b minus d close parentheses times n sub t. Equation 1.3. The parenthetical term in equation 1.3 is a constant multiplier of population change. It is usually termed the discrete or finite rate of population growth, simplified as lambda, such that n sub t plus 1 equals lambda n sub t. Equation 1.4. Thus, lambda is the proportional rate of change in population size from one discrete time step to the next discrete time step, such that lambda equals n sub t plus 1 divided by n sub t. Equation 1.5. Although the use of discrete time intervals can be empirically defended insofar as germination or breeding often occurs at a specific time each year for many species, deaths need not be similarly timed, often occurring continuously. Mathematically, it can be convenient to simplify population growth as a process that occurs continuously, meaning that changes in population size can be modelled as occurring over extremely small intervals of time, known as instantaneous change. A change in population size, n, over such an infinitesimally short period of time, partial differential t, is represented by the partial differential of n with respect to t. In continuous time, as described above, the number of births is a function of population size, the instantaneous per capita birth rate, b equals births divided by n, and the instantaneous per capita death rate, d equals deaths divided by n. Thus, in continuous time, population growth rate is described by the partial differential of n with respect to t is equal to b times n minus d times n, equation 1.6, or the partial differential of n with respect to t is equal to open parentheses b minus d close parentheses times n, equation 1.7. Note that this instantaneous rate of population change is controlled by the difference between the per capita rates of birth and death. Lotka described this difference as R equals B minus D, equation 1.8, terming R the rate of natural increase per head or the per capita rate of natural increase. Substituting equation 1.8 into equation 1.7 yields the standard model for population growth rate in continuous time. The partial differential of n with respect to t is equal to rn, equation 1.9, which means that r equals 1 divided by n multiplied by the partial differential of n with respect to t, equation 1.10. Fisher defined R similarly, as have most life history researchers since, but he called it the Malthusian parameter of population increase. According to Cole, Lotka was inconsistent in what he called R, variously describing it as the true, incipient, inherent, and intrinsic rate of increase. Cole, among others, settled on intrinsic rate of natural increase. This is generally what R has been called since. The ecological literature on lambda and r can sometimes be confusing because the parameters often seem to be used interchangeably, but they do differ in important ways. Lambda is measure of population growth rate, that is, the change in population size from one time step to another, whereas r is a measure of per capita population growth rate. Lambda can be thought of as the average contribution of each individual alive at time t to the size of the population at time t plus 1, whereas r is the average contribution of each individual to the rate of change in population size. The two parameters are related to one another. Lambda equals e raised to the power r, and r equals the natural logarithm of lambda. 1.2.2 Density-independent population growth. Whatever one calls R, it is quite important to remember that it is the per capita population growth rate. Consulting equation 1.10, the units of R are individuals per individual per unit of time. By contrast, population growth rate, equation 1.9, represented in continuous time by the partial differential of n with respect to t, has units of individuals per unit of time. Failure to distinguish per capita population growth from population growth is inexcusably common in the scientific literature. The discrete, equation 1.5, and continuous, equation 1.9, models of population growth are both geometric or exponential functions. We describe this exponential growth by an equation that plots changes in population size over time, such that n sub t equals n sub 0 times e to the power r times t, equation 1.11. where n sub 0 is the starting population size. Under these circumstances, we find n increasing steadily without bounds, figure 1.2. This pattern of change in n with t is also called density-independent population growth. Under density-independent population growth, figure 1.2, the per capita population growth rate, r, remains constant. It does not change with population size, n. Rather, it remains at a maximal level, R-max, the maximum per capita population growth rate, dashed line in figure 1.3. To improve clarity, equation 1.9 can be better expressed as the partial differential of n with respect to t is equal to r sub max multiplied by n, equation 1.2. Thus, under exponential growth, the population size at any time t, n sub t, depends on two parameters, numbers that remain constant, and one variable, numbers that take on different values, such that n sub t depends on the starting population size, n sub 0, a parameter, the maximum intrinsic rate of increase, r max, also a parameter, and time, t, a variable. N sub t equals n sub 0 e raised to the power, open parentheses, r sub max times t, close parentheses. Equation 1.13. Equation 1.13, analogous to equation 1.11, produces a curve similar in shape to that in figure 1.2. The basic equation is used to model exponential changes in population size with changes in time. The phrase exp, open parentheses, r sub max times t, close parentheses, has come to mean to exponentiate the bracketed term, such that exp, open parentheses, x, close parentheses, equals e raised to the power x. 1.2.3. Density-dependent population growth. Under the density-independent model, exponential growth, birth and death rates are assumed to be constant. Indeed, there is good empirical evidence that populations can experience exponential growth when their size is small relative to the numbers of individuals that their environment can sustain, that is, their carrying capacity, K. As closed populations increase in abundance or density, their per capita growth rate, R, inevitably changes as competition for increasingly limited resources, such as space and food, becomes increasingly intense. Now it becomes useful to distinguish realized per capita growth, R realized, from maximum per capita growth, R max. Increased competition can have the effect of reducing the realized per capita birth rate and/or increasing the realized rate of per capita death. This means that as N increases, R realized, which equals B minus D, must decline. Figure 1.4. The simplest means of incorporating an effect of increasing density, higher n in a closed population, on population growth rate, is to reduce the partial differential of n with respect to t by an amount proportional to the remaining portion of the carrying capacity, k, such that the partial differential of n with respect to t is equal to r sub max times n, open parentheses, 1 minus n divided by k, close parentheses. Equation 1.14. This equation describes a continuous, density-dependent or logistic model in which population growth rate, the partial differential of n with respect to t, initially increases with increasing n, reaching a maximum value at 0.5k, and declines thereafter, eventually reaching zero when n equals k. Figure 1.5. The pattern of population growth in figure 1.5 produces a sigmoidal or logistic curve when describing changes in population size over time, figure 1.6. At small population sizes, density-dependent populations often grow curvilinearly, sometimes exponentially. But as population size continues to increase, the rate of growth reaches a peak at 0.5k and then begins to decline, resulting in an ever-decreasing rate as n approaches carrying capacity, figure 1.6. Note that the slope of the sigmoidal curve in figure 1.6 represents the population growth rate, that is, the partial differential of n with respect to t. According to this classic model of density-dependent growth, equation 1.4, per capita population growth attains its maximum, R max, at the lowest viable population size, declining linearly with increasing n until n equals k, solid line in figure 1.4. The pattern of declining R realized with declining abundance is called negative density dependence. Some species, however, experience positive density dependence at small population sizes. Under these circumstances, if populations fall below an abundance or density threshold, R realized begins to decline as populations become increasingly smaller, figure 1.7. This results in a range of population sizes at which R realized increases rather than declines with increasing abundance, producing positive density dependence. The pattern of positive density dependence between R realized and population size is termed an alley effect, subsection 9.6.2. 1.3. Life history traits. In laying a basic foundation for understanding the origins of life history research, this chapter has identified four core elements. Two relate to the timing of changes in survival and fecundity throughout an individual's life. These are age-specific survival, L sub X, and age-specific fecundity, B sub X. The third relates to the concept of reproductive effort, a measure of the investment or energy that individuals allocate to all aspects of reproduction. This comes at some reproductive cost, the fourth core element of a life history, likely to manifest at a minimum as a reduction in the probability of surviving to future ages. As noted previously, a life history describes how genotypes vary their age or stage-specific expenditure of reproductive effort in response to extrinsic and intrinsic factors that affect age-specific survival and fecundity. Thus, life history theory provides an explanatory and predictive framework for understanding why organisms differ in the means by which they propagate their genes to future generations. This raises the question of what constitutes a life history trait. Cole defined a life history trait as a life history feature that affects reproductive potential and is subject to natural selection. He identified age at maturity, fecundity, that is, number of offspring, and lifespan as being life history traits. To these three, most contemporary life history researchers would add size at maturity, size of offspring or propagule, and individual growth rate. Other general attributes have been identified as being life history traits. One of these is reproductive effort. As will be discussed in Chapter 4, one potential measure of effort is the proportional allocation of body mass to reproductive tissues, including offspring mass. This has the advantage of being a quantitatively tractable measure that can be compared among organisms across diverse taxa. However, by restricting the definition to the proportional allocation of body mass to reproductive tissue, one risks overlooking other potential determinants of reproductive effort, such as mate competition, migration, and parental care, and ignoring or underestimating potential costs, for example, to future survival. A second broadly applicable attribute, sometimes identified as a life history trait, is offspring sex ratio. Deviations from a 1-to-1 ratio are exhibited by dioecious plant species, male-biased flowering.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.